Well, look, so we're gonna begin in a moment out of 2 Corinthians chapter 11. But, you know, before we get started with the message, maybe just kind of like an introduction to the message, you know, as I was reading and studying and had prepared this particular message, the Lord first put it in my heart to preach it this morning. And to be honest with you, I ended up preaching some version of it at Isabella's school on Friday, although the Lord did definitely take over and he filled my mouth with a lot of other things that I didn't expect. But as I was taking a look at the letter of 2 Corinthians, which was written by the Apostle Paul to the church of Corinth, I don't want to spend too much time on the city of Corinth, but let's just say it was basically kind of like New Orleans on steroids, or Amsterdam. If you've ever been to Amsterdam, I've been to Amsterdam before, and it's a mess over there too. Prostitution's rampant, drugs are sold on the street, they're legal. Corinth was similar in that sense that they had the temple to Delphi, and there were temple prostitutes. That's how they worshiped pagan gods. And these, whenever it came, the sun would set, these women prostitutes would come down and filter into the streets. And there were two different ports in the city of Corinth, which means that there were sailors there all of the time. And so really and truly, to have been one who lived a lifestyle of what we could use the terminology debauchery or lasciviousness. Those are old King James words for lustfulness and unbridled passions, nothing holding you back. You know what a bridle is? It's something you put on a horse and tell them, hey, whoa, slow down. Don't keep going in that way. Well, unbridled lust was rampant in the city of Corinth. And as a matter of fact, if you gained the reputation of being like a partier to that level, then you were known as someone who had been Corinthianized. And so that was the element where this church was birthed, where the Apostle Paul, as he began to travel the Mediterranean Sea preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, he planted this church in the city of Corinth. And so you can imagine the atmosphere that was there. And you and I all know that as Christians and the things that we've struggled with as we gave our heart to the Lord, how the enemy doesn't really give up really easy. And he wants to continue to throw bait in our face. He wants to continue to get us to go in a particular direction that's contrary to the Word of God, contrary to the will of God. And I want you to know that as we move through the midst of this message, that's one of the main things that I want you to understand is this, is that there's pressure. You're going to be pressured from various sides. Everywhere that you turn, the enemy's goal is to get you off the path of true Christianity. Now, the reason that I say true Christianity is because I need you to also know this, that there's a brand developing out there that labels itself Christian, but in reality, it's not the true Christianity that's preached in the gospel. And I'm going to just tell you right now, and I'm not going to apologize for it because I'm getting tired of apologizing for the truth. Amen. You're going to run into people that are going to tell you, and I've had multiple people tell me, dude, I just don't like your style. I don't like the way you talk. I don't like your style. I don't like your personality, because everything that comes out of your mouth is negative, because when I go to church, I'm supposed to feel good. I'm supposed to leave feeling good about myself. I'm here to tell you that the Bible, Jesus called the self-righteous Pharisees. He said, you're like a bunch of whitewashed tombs filled with dead men's bones. The outside looks clean. You got yourself put together, but the inside is full of death. And the truth of the matter is that the Apostle Paul called people out and told them, you're preaching a lying gospel, you've shipwrecked the faith of some, and you've caused it like a gangrene in their lives to destroy them. And I'm here to tell you, the same devil that was alive then is alive today, and there's a modern movement that's taking place in the church. Come on, somebody. And what, it's got an entertainment spirit behind it. And the music here is just to entertain people and to bring them in by the droves. And you know, one of the interesting things that happened to me was this, was that when I walked into that chapel service, it was a beautiful thing when I preached Friday at that school. 300 kids filled the auditorium, and one girl walked in. She said, this is my favorite chapel day. I said, why is that? She said, because you're preaching. And you know, listen, okay, good. Give her a fist bump. Thanks for the encouragement, sis. But you know, I got up there and I started thinking to myself, I've heard that on more than one occasion, that they love it when I come. Even the principal, I said, man, I just want to thank you for letting me come in. I know you had something to do with it. He said, I just keep hearing it over and over again. When's Matt coming? When's Matt coming? Wow. When's Matt coming? But this is the thing. I preach harder there than I do in here. And so one of the things, and all I ever hear about young people is, man, we got to make it cool. We got to make it relevant. We got got to make it so, you know, like, well, it's hip now. We want to draw the kids in. And what I'm finding out is they just want the truth. Yeah. A young person can smell a fall. When I was young and doing drugs and running out there on the streets, I knew when you were fake. I'm not dumb. I can see it. I can see through the lies. If I've come this far and I'm going to sit in a church for an hour or more on a Sunday morning, I want the truth, man. Give me the truth. Hallelujah. There's a pervasive theme that runs through 2 Corinthians, the letter to the church of Corinth. And one of them is that Paul's calling out false apostles. He's calling out false apostles. He's calling out false doctrine. But there's this other underlying theme that he keeps talking about. It's about pressure. I got to tell you something, that the Apostle Paul, we're about to get into some of the things that he went through. There's pressure on this path. That's the title of my message this morning, The Pressure of the Path. And I want you to know that the enemy of your soul, he wants to do everything that he can to get you off this path. I'm talking about the true path of Christianity. I'm not just talking about showing up to church once a week or whatever the case. I'm talking about Jesus coming alive on the inside of your heart and the Holy Spirit beginning to do a movement on the inside of who you are. And listen to me, when you really get saved and the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of you, he starts moving things around. I know I keep saying it, but I got to keep on saying it. He won't leave you the same way that he found you. He started changing things. Hallelujah. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's how it's written. That's how it's supposed to be preached. And that's what's been taking place for thousands of years since Jesus died on the cross. Amen. And so listen to me. What we need to understand also is that, you know, let's just take a little bit of time here. And you know, I know that I draw this a lot. I drew it for the kids for the first time. But you know, one little girl came up to me afterwards. That was the beautiful thing about it, because I'm not real good at altar calls. I'm like, if you want prayer, come up here. And you know, it's kind of like the whole message ended like kind of abruptly. I asked the principal, because I preached for a long time. I'm like, do we have time for a song? They cut off the lights. They started playing the song. And I told the kids, I said, I'm not good at begging people. But I will tell you this, I want to pray with you. And all of a sudden, they were just sitting down and said, you know what, stand up for me. Stand up, at least, and worship the Lord. And when I told them to stand up, they just all started piling out. And there must have been 50, 60 kids up at the front there crying. And the Lord dealing with their hearts. And one of the things I did was I drew for them what I draw for y'all all the time. And this little girl came up to me afterwards and she said, I just got saved a month ago and I've been reading the Bible. And what you did to me was you finally explained to me what Christianity means.
Oh, wow.
You explained to me what Christianity means. That, see, the first time you were born like your father Adam. Amen. Most of us know this already if you've been coming to church. But maybe this is for somebody that hasn't been coming to church here. And that the Bible says that Jesus, the precious one, see, God's whole plan was all revolved around God sending his only begotten son, the sinless one, to die on the cross for our sins. That's the whole purpose of Israel, so that he could give us Jesus. And one day you heard the gospel of Jesus Christ and him crucified. You can't have a Jesus without a cross, because the reality of it is that the whole purpose of Jesus was him to be a sacrifice, a sinless sacrifice, to pay the penalty for your sin and for my sin. Because see, that's the problem with humanity. And listen to me, church. That's the problem not just with the unbeliever. That's the problem once we get saved. Sin still tries to stand as a partition between us and the presence of God. And when we can get into the presence of God, he begins to heal us. I prayed with one girl at the altar and I said, Lord, you're like medicine. You're the balm of Gilead. Lord, I pray that you would be medicine in her life and that you bring healing to her. And I'm telling you right now, the Lord just got all over her and started dealing with her. See, I don't know what she's been through. I don't know what goes on in her home. I don't know what takes place between, you know, what her parents do. You just don't even know what goes on in people's lives. Come on, somebody, help me out. You don't know what people have been through. And people are hurt and they're in pain because we live in the midst of a fallen earth. And there's pressure on this earth, because the enemy wants to get us off the path so that others don't hear the good news of the gospel. But listen, whenever you were here, you were broken and dead like Adam. But when you heard the gospel and you put faith in it, see, faith is your part. I need you to know that. God's part was getting us Jesus. He did his part.
Amen.
He was born of a virgin. Amen. He was without sin. And Jesus is obedience to the Father. He accomplished the will of the Father. He went to the cross like a lamb led to the slaughter. He opened not his mouth. And he went to the cross and he paid the penalty. And all of the sins of humanity was laid upon him. And he did his part. And now your part is when you hear the gospel, you're to respond to it by faith. Amen. Not because the preacher's telling you to do it. Because if you're going to have a relationship with God, then you're going to go God's way. See, he's the potter, we're the clay. The clay doesn't tell the potter how it's going to get done. Now, you can do that. See, he gave you a free will. Hey, come on, Lord, take over this message this morning. He gave you a free will. And you can do whatever it is that you want to do, but the end thereof may not be what you were looking for at the end of your path. And that's what we're talking about also this morning is a path. There's pressure on the path, trying to prevent you from ever getting on the path. And then once you get on the path, every devil in hell is trying to get you off the path any way, shape, or form that it can, because ultimately the enemy of your soul wants to destroy yours and other people's souls. But I told them, listen, through faith, God allowed a transaction to take place. And I wanted to explain that to you this morning, that in Colossians 1:13, the scripture says that you were translated. You were translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. A beautiful thing happened when you heard the gospel, if you've responded by faith. When you heard the gospel and you placed faith in it, the Holy Spirit translated you. He took you out of the kingdom of darkness when you were born of Adam, broken and dead. He translated you into the kingdom of his dear son. The Holy Ghost put you in Jesus where you died with him. You were buried with him. And even as he was raised from the dead, you too should walk in newness of life. You've been given a new life, a new position. Now you're in Christ. But what I need you to understand is that your faith in what Christ has done is almost, if I could use an analogy like this, it almost acted as a vehicle bringing you from one place to another place. You traveled in Christ from your death in the world where you became one with him. You need to understand something. This is some deep theology, but you need to wrap your mind around this. You became one with him. You came into vital union with him. You were unified with Jesus in his death and his burial and his resurrection from the dead. Hallelujah. Where through that miracle that took place in the spiritual realm, the old man that was born of Adam was done away with, and he was translated into a new kingdom where now there is grace. So I need you to understand, I wanted you to understand, if you're saved this morning and you put your faith in Christ, you've been translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. Let me tell you something else that happened to you, and I use this scripture a lot, Ephesians 1:13. It says that when you heard the gospel message and you put your faith in it, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise.
Thank you, Lord.
The Holy Spirit showed up in your life. These two things happen to you if you're a born-again believer. Number one, the Holy Spirit came to live in you. Number two, you were translated from one kingdom into another kingdom. But now I got to tell you, you're on the path. You're on the path now, the journey of Christianity. The Bible says that God's people have always been on a journey. Y'all hear me talk about this a lot. Try not to take a nap and just hold on with me. But I need you to understand that this is also a common theme that takes place throughout the entirety of Scripture. The Bible says that Abraham, who was the father of Israel, Israel came out of him. Y'all know that, right? It says that Abraham looked for a city whose builder and maker was God. That means that Abraham was looking for something bigger than today, and he understood that the God that he served had something big for humanity on the horizon. And that's what Abraham looked forward to. The Bible says that the nation of Israel, God's people, were on a journey. They were strangers in a foreign land. The Bible says that in the New Testament, Peter says that you're pilgrims. You're sojourners on a journey. You live in the midst. This world is not your home. Amen. And sometimes when you find yourself traveling in the midst of this world and you take your stand against the world system, you're going to find out that it's true. You're not of this world. You're a foreigner in a strange land. You know, the script Jesus said in John 15, if the world hates you, remember something, they first hated me. See, that's why whenever people don't really understand the gospel, they haven't really read the scriptures in their totality, you'll realize, no, everybody didn't love Jesus. As a matter of fact, whenever it came down to it, when he said it in John chapter 6, he said, "You, my flesh is meat indeed, my blood is drink indeed, and you will either eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, or you will have none of me." No, we want your miracles, Lord. We want your good teaching, Lord, but don't talk to us about blood. Don't talk to us about sacrifice. Don't talk to us about death. Why? Because my flesh doesn't want to die. There's stuff in me that I want. I want to have this relationship with this particular person if that's what I want to have. I want to be able to numb my senses a little bit if that's what I feel like doing, is just getting a little bit numb on the weekend. I want to be able to continue to live my life any old way that I want to and still have God. No, sir, no, ma'am, it doesn't work that way.
Amen.
It doesn't work that way. The cross is an instrument of death, and it kills the flesh. It kills that which is born of Adam. I didn't write the book. The Holy Spirit wrote the book, and he said that you will die in Christ. Now listen, it doesn't happen all overnight. When you come to the realization that yes, I do want God, and you say yes to the real Jesus, and the Holy Spirit moves in, he begins the process. Amen.
Amen.
It's the preacher's job just to tell you the truth.
Amen.
It's the preacher's job not just to tell you the truth, but for him to submit to the truth. You think the preacher ain't got his own flesh problems? You think the preacher ain't got his own stuff that he wants to hold on to and that he doesn't want to die? Come on, somebody help me out here. We're all human beings.
Amen.
The enemy wants to try to put pressure on each and every one of us to get us off the path so that we don't continue the journey. I'm here to talk to you this morning about being translated into a kingdom, about being sealed by the Holy Ghost, about being a real Christian, about being on a path and a journey, but to understand there's pressure on it.
Yes.
And it's a spiritual warfare.
Amen.
Amen.
This morning I woke up and I was looking, thinking about the scripture, and you know, all of a sudden this story, I was reminded of this story. The camera's on, right? I was reminded of this thing that happened. And it's kind of like, I don't really know how to describe it. It was something that happened in the physical, but I felt like it was very spiritual. And when I tell you this story that happened in the physical, I want you to be aware that it's kind of like that in the spiritual. That when you give your life to the Lord, there's fallen angels and demon spirits, and they're the ones many times that are applying the pressure in various circumstances, trying to get you off the path. At the same time, God is allowing events to be orchestrated so that you might be tested, to be proven to be the Christian that you say you are. But the enemy wants to destroy you. God wants to prove you, put you to the test.
Yeah.
But the enemy wants to destroy you and get you off the path. No, this is the story. We went to Branson, Missouri. And this place called Ozark, Missouri, there was a canoe thing. I wanted to go canoeing, right? I want to be adventurous. And so I brought my two girls, and I brought my mother-in-law, and I brought my sister-in-law. All right? Danielle's like, "You crazy, I'm staying at the group." All right? Well, you know what? It was still cold outside, and I called the old boy up and said, "Look, man, I got some young kids, you know, whatever. Is it rough? I don't know. I'm not a kayaker. I've been in a P-Rog before, but I'm not a kayaker." You know? And he said, "Oh, no, man, got a little bit of, you know, some grade one, twos, you know, but this, you're all good, bro." I don't know what a grade one or two is, but I trusted the old boy. So we get us a couple of canoes. He gives us about a 5-minute lesson on how to dig the paddle into the water, and off we go. It's nice and tranquil and serene and everything. Man, we just stopped off on this little, not long into the trip. Look at all these rocks over here. Let's get home. Let's eat our little sandwich, and then we'll just continue on down the creek. And then all of a sudden, dude, it started getting bad. The rapids started getting bad. And you know, and the next thing you know, the boats tip over, all right? And I can remember looking Sierra in the eyes as her little head was starting to bob down. And I had the Isabella in one hand, and I looked at Sierra and I said, "You have to get to the bank. I can't save both of y'all." And so I started swimming across, and I didn't see her again. I saw my mother-in-law and my sister-in-law floating down the creek, and I pull Belle up on the bank, and then I see Sierra. She's struggling, but boy, I go over there and I pull her up on the bank, and then I see my sister. I see my mother-in-law flailing in the water. No, she was holding on to a branch on a tree over there across the creek. She grabbed onto a branch, and I see my sister-in-law. She's holding on to the boat, and I start swimming down there, and I grab her. I said, "Thank you for holding on to the boat," and I pull her over to the side, and then I get back up to go check on my girls, and Sierra's like, "Dad, a snake just swam through my legs." I said, "Girl, you're crazy. Don't tell me it's some kind of craziness. She said, there it is, Dad, swimming in the water. You ain't gonna believe this. Dude, I'm telling you, the enemy wanted to do something that day. He swam straight for that tree where my mother-in-law was. He squirmed up that tree. He got on a branch and he was looking right down at her. And his little snake tongue was just slithering out of his mouth. I said, dude, I gotta go get my mother-in-law. She can't swim. She's holding on to this branch. The current's just dragging her out. I get over there. I swim across. I'm like, Miss Angela, you gotta let go of the limb. You gotta let go. I gotta get you back across the other side. I ain't letting go. I'm not gonna let go. I said, you gotta let go of this limb. And she just kept saying, no, I'm not letting go. And all of a sudden, I said, look at that branch. Look at that snake right there. When she's like, ah, she let go of it, right? So I grabbed her and I pulled her across the creek. I'm like, oh, Lord Jesus. What was I thinking? What did I get myself into? So we get in the boat. I'm like, it's going to be okay. We got the boats. We got everybody. Let's head on down. Because we ain't never going to get out of here. I don't want nobody calling no helicopter for us. Right? And so we start back on our little journey. Well, here's another fork in the road. Oh, dude, a literal fork in the creek where it goes this way, and in the middle, there's all these huge trees, and everything is pushing everything right to the middle. And I'm thinking, dig in, girls, hit the hook, because we ain't going up in that. That's trouble. And I holler back there at them. I'm like, make sure you go on the left to turn your boat to the right. And it was almost like they were playing patty cake with the water. They were like, they were splash. And the next thing you know, they floated straight into that thing, and they're stuck. Their boat's flipped over. The current's rushing up against the boat. I probably weighed about 240 pounds at the time, and I pulled the boat over to the side. I told the girls, look, I got to go over there and help them. Y'all stay right here and don't move. I get down there, and anyway, I helped them across, but the boat's stuck. I mean, dude, the canoe is flipped over underneath the water, and the water's pushed it up against all of this stuff, and it's like this raging, pretty hard current pushing everything towards this thing. I'm like, Lord Jesus, what am I going to do? Because at the time, I'm going to be honest with you, I was on fire for the Lord. And I'm thinking to myself, how in the world did I get myself caught up in the midst of this mess? I mean, dude, it felt like it was an attack of the enemy. You understand what I'm saying? I know I'm a fool for going out there and trying to take on nature, but it was almost like the enemy was waiting. I wanted to get you out of your environment. I own this wilderness out here, boy. And so the next thing you know, I said, I'm going to put my big old body up against this thing. I put my leg up against it, and I'm pushing, and ain't nothing out. I said, oh, Lord, please. And look, he moved about that much. I'm like, oh, yeah, it's on now. You got to go. And I pushed and pushed, and next thing you know, I got about half of it out there. That current took that thing and slung that, and I started swimming after. I got to get that boat. And, you know, so anyway, make a long story short, I got the boat. I put everybody back in the boat. I said, listen to me, you just stay straight and you just ride these rabbits. We're gonna make it home. We're gonna get out of here, and thank God we did. But you know, sometimes it's a physical thing. I just remembered that. It was a physical situation, but it had this spiritual tone, and the enemy was like attacking and coming from every side. And I don't know about you, but sometimes in the spiritual, when we're walking this thing out called Christianity, it can feel like that. You start getting hit from every side, pressure points coming from all kinds of directions, and the whole time the enemy's just trying to, you know, and it's not just about coming to church, but he's trying to keep you from missing church. It's so that you don't hear the word of God. It's so that you don't hear about the God that saved you, amen, and he wants to fill you up with his presence and strengthen you so that you can continue on the journey so that you can live your life out for the Lord.
Amen.
Now, I can tell you that Paul went through a whole lot more than I did that day, amen, but I want you to see, and I hope to God that you and I never have to go through what the Apostle Paul went through. But this is what some of what Paul went through in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. See, there he's addressing false apostles right here. He's talking about, he says, are they ministers of Christ? See, they've been talking bad about him behind his back. I speak as a fool. I am more in labors. In other words, I've done more for the kingdom of God than what they have. I'm more in labors. I'm more in stripes above measure, in prison more frequent, and deaths often. In other words, I've been in prison for this gospel. I've received stripes on my back. The lictor's lash, that's what they called the Roman soldier that was in charge of the whip. They called him a lictor. The lictor's lash has hit my back more often than these other old boys, and it's all because of the gospel. He says in verse 24, of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. That means 39 stripes. There was a Roman rule that you couldn't whip a Roman citizen. See, people think that Jesus only got hit 39 times. Jesus was a Jew. And so that's not reality. We don't know that for sure, because the scripture doesn't say how many times Jesus was hit. Jesus was not a Roman citizen, but that instead, Paul was a Roman citizen, though, so they couldn't beat him more than 39 times. But five different times he was beaten 39 licks with a lictor's lash. And, you know, I think I even mentioned this the last time I preached, or maybe I mentioned it to the kids, but it's something called a keloid scar. You ever seen a keloid scar? They're like real, real thick and they're real, real high. And I would imagine his back was full of them. And not only that, he goes on to say that thrice, that's another word for three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day I've been in the deep. Maybe that's why I thought of that story. Apostle Paul was shipwrecked as he was going in the Mediterranean Sea to preach the gospel to all of these various places that God, and the ship wrecked. And he was left in the sea throughout a whole day and a whole night. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to be left in the sea a whole day and a whole night, especially not at night, things bumping on your feet, not knowing exactly what it is. Dude, I don't care how tough you think you are, that is not a good place to be. He goes on to say, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, even my own countrymen, the Jewish people, they hate me because I'm over here preaching Jesus. In perils by the heathen, that means people that don't know God. In perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils amongst false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. I can see the Apostle Paul, for whatever reason, he lost some of his clothes. I mean, no telling. I mean, one of them times whenever they ripped his clothes, maybe they ripped the clothes off his body whenever they whipped him one time and just threw him out on the street. And he's over there naked. Can you imagine that? I mean, you've been beat to an inch of your life. You have no clothes on. You're walking down the street. The humiliation. And then nighttime hits and it's cold outside and he doesn't have any clothes and he's shivering in the cold. And sometimes we think that we got something going on in our life that's causing some trouble. And what this man does, though, is somehow the whole He cries out to the Holy Spirit. He finds a fortitude and a grace and a strength and a power from God to get up one more time and to keep on going, because he has gotten a revelation. The Holy Spirit has grabbed a hold of him and apprehended him and revealed the truth to him, to the point that, hey, like Abraham, he was looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. There's something bigger than this world down here and all of the things that we're going through, and the Lord wants us to get a revelation of that. And understand, the enemy of your soul is trying to put pressure on you to get you off the path, to try to make you quit. I thank God that he had somebody like the Apostle Paul, that he could whisper in his ear and say, come on, Paul, just one more time. Just get up one more time. I'm going to be with you. I know it hurts. I know that them gouges in your back hurt, but I'm with you. Come on, Paul, get up one more time. We got to work. We got to do. Listen to me. You're not going to convince me that the Apostle Paul didn't have a revelation that you and I need. He was convinced that God is real. It just wasn't church on Sunday for him. The God of glory came alive on the inside of him, and he was pressing forward. Now, in the midst of all of that, I want you to know, if you turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. Second Corinthians 2, verse 14. In the midst of all of this that Paul has been through, this is like a scripture that he gives us. It's interesting because this guy that usually sends me scripture sent me the scripture this morning. And I was like, wow, thank you, Jesus, a confirmation. Amen. It says, now thanks be unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ and makes manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved and them that perish. Now we're going to break this down a little bit, the word savor, and explain what that means. But what I want you to see is this, is that he's talking about triumph. And he's talking about making manifest Jesus. And that the manifestation, making something manifest, means making it visible to where you're able to see it. Amen. It becomes visible to the eye to where you're able to see it. And what's being made manifest is the savor of the knowledge of Jesus. And so there's another scripture in Colossians chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. We don't have to turn there. I mean, I'm just going to kind of like paraphrase it. I mean, if they can put it up there on the screen, that's cool. Colossians 2, 14 and 15. But the idea of the scripture is this, that he, talking about Jesus, took the ordinances of death that were against us. That's talking about the law. The law was against you. You realize that because you couldn't keep the law.
Right.
And you had failed God. He took the ordinances of death that were against us and that he nailed them to his cross. And then the Bible says that he triumphed over principalities and powers. That's talking about fallen angels and demon spirits. In it. He made an open spectacle of them, the scripture says. He made an open spectacle of principalities and powers, and he triumphed over them in it, talking about the cross. And so what I want you to know is that the connection between those two scriptures is this word triumph. And the whole idea here is built upon a Roman processional military parade. And during the Roman Empire, when the Roman Empire would defeat another kingdom, what would happen is that the victorious general would strip the enemy and its leaders of all of its power, all of its armor, and shackle them. And then they would await, when they arrived in the city, there would be a parade or a processional celebration waiting for the returning victorious general. Jesus, when he died on the cross, he made an open spectacle of it as he ascended into the heavenly realms. He made it, and he went through the spiritual realm where the fallen angels and the demon spirits are. He triumphed over them when he went to the cross. He broke the power of sin when he went to the cross. You and I are free today, amen? He made an open spectacle of them as he paraded victory in front of their very eyes. But I want you to get this picture. Not only was there a parade where now the enemy is shackled. See, the enemy's shackled in your life because of what Jesus did. Amen. We got to learn how to believe that. Not only is the enemy shackled, but there's plumes of incense being burned. Plumes of incense being burned in the city. You can about imagine this. I mean, the people are up on the walls of the city and they're cheering their victorious general. And the victorious general is coming in and he's got the defeated foe that are marching out in front of him, stripped of all their power, stripped of all their armor. And huge plumes of incense fill the air and the smell of victory is in the air. The Apostle Paul said that we bring forth the savor. We make it, God allows us to make manifest the savor of the knowledge of Jesus Christ.
Wow.
The Apostle Paul saw himself, he's just like a one-man show. Sometimes it's him and Barnabas, sometimes it's him and Titus and Timothy, but it's like he just continues on. And the way that the savor of the knowledge of Jesus Christ is made manifest is as he proclaims the gospel of Jesus Christ in the air, and he proclaims the victory that Jesus won on the cross. Then as he begins to proclaim the victory of Jesus, the air is filled with like an incense of victory, and it's a sweet smelling savor in the nostrils of God. In spite of the shipwrecks, in spite of the prison, in spite of the whippings and the beatings, hallelujah, the air will be filled with the savor of the knowledge of Jesus, because as long as he's with me, I'm going to say it one more time. I'm going to proclaim it one more time. And when you get saved, come on, Christian.
Amen.
When you get saved, the God of glory, he wants to come on the inside of you, and he wants to live in you. And you might not be like the Apostle Paul, and you may not even stand behind a pulpit, but he's going to give you an opportunity to proclaim the name of Jesus in the air. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And sometimes you're going to find pressure from all kinds of different ways. They're going to try to get you off the path. And let me tell you this too, when you start talking about Jesus, the people are going to start watching you more closely.
Yeah. Amen.
Sometimes they have a right to, but sometimes they're just looking for any old excuse.
Amen.
So that they can make you look bad. Mm. Come on, somebody, help me out. You just get ready, bro. I learned something from somebody that comes to this church. They pulled this number, and guess what? I learned it from them, and I did it the other day at work. I walked in, and I don't even really remember what happened. They said, oh, we're in your way. I said, that's right, y'all are in my way. Get out the way. And I was joking with them, and we all laughed. And one of the nurses said something, and I said, you gonna do it? She said, no, I'm gonna tell Jesus on you, boy. And so she, and I didn't even really do that bad, but everybody kind of started laughing. I said, that's all right. Tell Jesus on me. And so I broke out in a song. I said, he's still working on me. Make me what I ought to be. It took him just a day to make the moon and the stars, Jupiter and Mars, but he's still working on me. I said, listen, sister, Jesus lives in my heart, but it don't mean I got it all figured out, and I didn't even really do nothing that bad, but you try to make me look bad in front of everybody. And from now on, when you do that, I'm going to bust up with that song. So then it's kind of funny, because the other day, something happened, and one of the other girls, who doesn't even really know me that way, she said, you going to sing for us? I said, just start singing about Jesus if you don't want to. Anyway, the point that I'm trying to make is this. Is that on this pathway, you're going to find pressure from everywhere that you go. We aren't perfect people, hallelujah, but we are being changed into the image of Jesus Christ because the Holy Spirit is going to work on the inside of us. And so, even in the midst of all of those trials and all of those tribulations and all of the pressure that the Apostle Paul was feeling and experiencing, he still said, we give thanks unto God, which always causes us to triumph in Christ. Amen. And he's making manifest the savor of the knowledge of Jesus Christ. That's part of your part too, Christian. You understand that, right? I used to be so blinded when I used to sit in other churches. It's one of the reasons I don't ever want to get paid. Lord, if I'm telling you right now, if I can get through this whole life and be a preacher of the gospel and not really go around getting really a salary for it, I'll be a happy person. Because I don't want to. Because you know what the thing of it is this. I mean, that's not. Listen, the scripture is real clear. It says, do not muzzle the ox when he's treading. In other words, you're supposed to pay the preacher the gospel.
That's right.
But for some reason, it's like the Lord put it in my heart. And if I don't ever have to get paid, I'll be happy. Because I don't want people saying, well, that's your job, preacher. You're supposed to tell people. No, it's our job.
Amen.
Christian.
Amen.
It's our job to have the light of glory on the inside of us and to share it with those out there that are lost.
Amen.
Amen. They won't preach this down the road. Because you know why? Oh, it makes me feel uncomfortable, preacher. No, that's not what I came to church for. Listen to me. I'm not telling you to stand up on the table at your work and start singing to him that he's still working on you. Don't do what I do. Amen. You're going to look really goofy. I don't mind looking goofy, man. But this is what I'm trying to tell you. You grow in Christ and let the Holy Spirit reveal to you how he wants to use you.
Amen.
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 You might find yourself one day like Troy up in the hair salon talking about Jesus or at the nursing home. And listen, I've been hearing from more and more people, dude. I just share Jesus. And that's one of the beautiful things that I've loved about what God's done in the people in this church. He's just made us vocal Christians. Amen. And some of our personalities are more calm. Our demeanors are different. And sometimes it's going to be a soft conversation about the fact, man, you know, I gave my life to Jesus and he changed me. All right? So you get the point I'm trying to make. All right. But we're still on the fact that there's pressure on the path. Chapter 4 of 2 Corinthians, chapter 4, verse 1. The Apostle Paul says, therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not. Not going to give up. There's a big ministry ahead of the Apostle Paul. There's a big ministry ahead of the Christian. Amen. You're on a journey and God has entrusted you. And we're about to see even more clearly what he's entrusted us with. But then he goes on to say, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. In other words, once again, the Apostle Paul has called out false apostles throughout the entirety of this letter. And he's saying this is something that we're not doing in the first part of the verse. We've renounced hidden things of dishonesty. We're not walking in craftiness, nor will we handle the word of God deceitfully. And I have to tell you that the Lord has showed this to me on more than one occasion. And basically, this is the essence of it. And I need you to understand that one of the first things that happened to me whenever the Lord first called me to preach, I'm just trying to be led by the Lord. And some of you know the story already. Tragedy struck my life. And I had this stronghold in my life where I kept going back to alcohol or I kept going back to whatever. And you know, the fact of the matter is that there's always a pressure on the path. And the enemy of your soul, he knows your tendencies. And he knows if he can get you in a certain circumstance that he'll get you to revert back to your old behavior like Adam instead of reverting to a new behavior like the child that's dependent upon the Lord and says, Lord, I come unto you. I'm dependent upon you. I need your grace, your help in this time. And so the enemy of my soul, he had observed my behavior and he knew what my tendencies were. And I found myself in the midst of a barroom again after 12 years of being a Christian. But in that barroom, the Holy Spirit showed up and he spoke to me. I'm not going to go through the whole concept, but one of the things he said was this: if you will present my word for the way it is written, I will use you. I didn't have a clue what that meant. Later I learned there were a lot of people that weren't presenting the word of God for the way that it was written. They're handling the word of God deceitfully. The modern church is full of that. People are, they're preaching, they're not even really preaching the gospel. They'll share scriptures, but they're twisting it, and they don't even half the time realize that they're doing it. You understand that? Do you understand that demon spirits are behind false doctrine? Demon spirits are behind false doctrine because they want to blind the eyes of the people. And so people are handling the word of God with deceit, and the people of God aren't growing in their understanding of the scriptures. And because they don't grow in their understanding of the scriptures, they don't know how to keep proper faith in God and his plan, which is what we wrote on the board, Jesus Christ and him crucified, which allows grace. See, when you keep, this is the first day you put faith right here, you got saved. But now you're on a journey, you're on a pathway, and guess what? The same way you received him, what? Faith. So shall you continue to walk in him. The object of your faith doesn't ever change.
Amen.
You keep faith anchored in what Jesus has done for you at the cross. Then what happens is this. God reciprocates. What does that mean? He gives grace.
Amen.
He, based upon your faith in his plan, he responds through grace. He strengthens you supernaturally and changes you inwardly. And he does things for you that you can't do for yourself. Amen. This isn't an AA program that we're in. No, this is Jesus Christ. And he kills old stuff and he resurrects new stuff. The old man is now a new creature in Christ. The DNA that you received from Adam, oh, hallelujah, you got new DNA now. Amen. What the psychologist said is a lie. He got his word from Sigmund Freud, who snorted coke and had an incestuous relationship with his daughter Anna. He ain't gonna listen to that, man. That's what the whole thing was built upon. The wisdom of human beings is not going to get anybody free from anything. It's just going to shackle them in a new arena, which is going to be a bunch of psychology and a bunch of self-help programs. And you and I can't help ourselves, brothers and sisters. If we're walking in true Christianity, we need the Holy Spirit to do it on the inside of us. And listen to me, the modern church has taken that. I know I preach this a lot, but they've taken psychology and they mixed it with their theology. They handle the word of God deceitfully. See, nobody wants to hear that I got to die. Well, I mean, we want to hear it, but we want the truth. You get the point that I'm making. No, people that aren't ready to hear that, they don't want to hear that. I got to die. My flesh has to die so that the Spirit of God can live.
Yes.
We taught that last week in 1 Kings. Adonijah, the king, Solomon's older brother, was a type of the flesh. He wanted to sit on the throne and rule, but the promise was given to Solomon, who was a type of the Spirit. His flesh says, no, I'm going to sit on the throne. But Jesus says, I want to be the king of your heart. And if you'll let me be the king of your heart and sit upon the throne of your heart, then I'll lead and guide you in all truth. Amen.
Yes, amen.
And I'll change you. I'll do things in you that you can't do for yourself. So Paul said, we don't handle the word of God deceitfully. And then he goes on to say in verse 3, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. He goes on in verse 4, he says, in whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Now, what does that say? I mean, you see that scripture. It says, the God of this world. I yelled that out at the kids at home, a Christian. I'm like, who's that talking about? And some kid in the middle of the crowd said, the devil. I said, that's right. The devil, the God of this world. He's blinding the eyes of them that don't believe. But listen to me. It's not just people that are unbelievers completely, right. but it's people that don't understand to believe the truth of the gospel. And instead, the word of God's been handled deceitfully by false apostles, and that now their eyes have been blinded to truth, and it's like scales have covered their eyes, and they can't be set free. Then I told you this a million times, that the church I used to preach at, that was the biggest complaint. People don't understand what you're saying. I'm saying the Bible. I'm saying that the Bible says we got to die in Christ. And so we can experience a new resurrection life. How hard is that? For you and I to understand that the first time I was born of Adam, I was born a mess and in sin. And God wants to get rid of that. Amen. And he wants to give new life. Amen. Now, I'm not saying that the Lord hadn't helped me explain it any better since those days. But you get the point. If you can't understand the things of God, the Word of God says. 1 Corinthians 2:14, the logical mind cannot perceive the things of God. They're spiritually understood. Amen. Amen. Until you get born again and the life of God comes to live on the inside of you, there is no way you can understand the things of God. But even if you're operating with a carnal mindset, carnal, what does that mean? Fleshly mindset, worldly mindset. You still want the world mixed up with your church. You see, I don't want to let go of this. And so I like this church over here because, man, it's entertaining. And we get it in 40 minutes, get some practical application from my life, tell me how to pay my bills, tell me how to fix this and whatever, and then I go home. No, that's not what God wants to do. God wants to fix your heart. He wants to fix my heart. Amen? Yeah. He wants to form Jesus on the inside of us, you know. And we see all of these things happening in the church. I remember telling those kids, I said, I can tell you what the gospel isn't. It isn't strobe lights and fog machines. Come on. Amen. I mean, they're doing that in youth groups across America. I've seen it in the churches that I went to. Whether they darken the lights and they put on fluorescent lights and they got this boom, 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 boom. And I walked in there one time Bella said, Daddy, I hate to say it, but it's like a club. I'm like, really? I walk in there and that's what it was. Dude, a massive kid. Boom, 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 boom. You know, and all I knew to do was to tell the dude, I said, hey, man, you're preparing these kids. You ain't gonna like it. Whenever somebody tells you something that you don't like, do you like it when people correct you? Because I personally, in the past, have not liked it when people do that. But at least I'm learning now that I'm not all okay. And that God knows how to bring correction to my life too, right? I remember one time that my boss told me something. I could feel this thing rise up in me. And I was like, dude, he's your boss. You better chill out. Even if what he's saying ain't true, you're going to learn something from it. Anyway, I told him, I said, dude, I hate to break the news to you, but you're preparing these kids to be comfortable more in a club than a church setting. This is not of the Lord.
Amen.
The bringing the world into the church is not the answer.
That's right. Yeah.
But you don't build a church off strobe lights, off of entertainment, off of fog machines, off of fluorescent lights, off of beatbox booming music. You don't build a church off of a hipster brand. What is a hipster? I don't know. Somebody please give me the definition. I think they wear skinny jeans and they look kind of like modern type hippies or something. And they're real cool young people. And that's what they do. We're hipsters, man. And that's their brand. And so now we got hipster churches. We got cowboy churches. And we got, you know, it's like, no, you build the church on the truth of the gospel and the foundation of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. It's the gospel message. It'd be one thing if they were wearing their skinny jeans and preaching Jesus, but they're not.
Amen.
They're not. What they're doing is they're providing an atmosphere and an environment where everybody just feels real comfortable. Mm-hmm. And so you feed my flesh. Mm-hmm. And it's a lying spirit that tells you, I'm in church, man. Mm-hmm. I'm okay. Me and the big man are good.
Right.
No, we're not good other than Jesus is the only one that was good. We put our faith in Him. Now we've been made right in the eyes of God. Amen. Does that make sense?
Amen.
You've been clothed with the righteousness of Christ. But the God of this world will blind the eyes of preachers and He will blind the eyes of those who hear their gospel. It goes on to say, this is what the gospel is though, right here, verse 6 of chapter 4. It says, for God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Do you see what he's doing there? The Holy Spirit through the Apostle Paul is bringing salvation back to creation. Let there be light was the word that was spoken on the first day of creation. Amen. That was a beautiful thing. I keep referencing those kids at that school, but it's like I was asking them questions. It's a beautiful thing to preach to a bunch of kids, even if they're not serving the Lord, they know the Bible, and they're like, "That was the first day of creation. Let there be light." Amen. The same God that spoke, "Let there be light," on the first day of creation, when you, because see, there was darkness over the face of the deep. And you in your personal life were filled with darkness, and you didn't know the things of God. And when the gospel of Jesus Christ, the light, the savor of the manifest knowledge of Jesus was spoken, and you said yes by faith, your faith placed in the gospel of Jesus Christ, a beautiful thing happened. God turned on a light. He said, "Let there be light." Amen. God spoke and light got turned on the inside of you. The light of God. The word of God says, "In him was light, and the light was the life of men." The life was the light of men. Amen. Jesus was the light, and the life that was given from God the Father to humanity. And when you receive him, your light comes on. But look, he continues on. He continues on with the concept of connecting creation to salvation. In verse 7, he says, "We have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us." Amen. Earthen vessels. Something that's formed from the earth. God made a vessel out of Adam. He reached down and he grabbed a lump of clay and he molded it and he breathed life into it. And then he placed his presence inside of Adam. Amen. He gave what the Bible says, he breathed his life into Adam, and Adam became a living soul. And you and I now are seen as earthen vessels through which God, now when we get saved and he turns the light on, he allows his glory to live on the inside of us, to shine on the inside of us. The Bible says we have this treasure that the glory of God in earthen vessels. You know what a treasure is? The treasure is a place where you store precious things. God has chosen to store his presence on the inside of you and on the inside of me. It's a treasure. You're an earthen vessel. Why did he choose to do it this way? So that the glory would be given to him and not unto us. There's a beautiful story that takes place in Judges chapter 7. The story is about Gideon. And if you'll remember the story of Gideon, it's during the time frame of the judges when the people of God aren't really serving God the way that they're supposed to. The Bible says there was no king, and each man did what was right in his own eyes. See, when Jesus isn't the king of your heart, sometimes you can allow yourself to do what's right in your own eyes. Amen. Some girl wrote a song a while back called "The Compass." Basically, she was saying, you just got to let your heart guide you. But the reality of it is that Jeremiah said, the heart of man is deceitfully wicked. Who can know it? My friend John stood up here the other night. He said, when your heart starts talking to you, tell it to shut up because it's lying. Amen? The word of God, though, when you put it on the inside of you, will begin to recreate and renew your mind and your thinking. Amen? Amen. But in the story of Gideon, what happens is that God wants to use Gideon to bring victory to the children of Israel. And there's 32,000 people. And God says, there's way too many. He said, you tell them that those that have fear in their heart, that they can go ahead and go home now. 22,000 of them left, and they were left with 10,000. Then the Lord told him, okay, one more test. You still got too many. Because see, if I let you win like this, the people are going to vaunt themselves. In other words, they're going to get prideful and puffed up. He said, no, I'm getting the glory today. He said, you tell them to drink water, and those that lap like a dog, I will keep them. And the ones that, so what they did, though, was that the ones that got down on both knees and put their face down in the water like this, but the ones that took their hand and did like that and lapped like a dog like that so that they could watch, those are the ones that God kept. There were 300 left when he was done. This was the mode that they were going to win with. They were going to take pitchers, clay pitchers, earthen vessels. They were going to put a light in them. They were going to put a light in them. They were going to have a trumpet. And he split them up into three different groups, from what I remember. And then they're going to blow the trumpet, and then they're going to break the pitchers, the clay vessels, the earthen vessels, so that the light could shine. And then they were going to attack. And when they did, all that, they sounded the trumpet. They broke the clay. The light shined, and the Midianites, the enemy, ran. See, the idea there is this, is that we have this treasure in earthen vessels. The glory of God lives on the inside of you, and whenever our clay begins to be broken, it begins to allow the light of God to shine. The trumpet is like the sound of the gospel going forth. The sound of what Jesus has done in your life going forth into the air. That sweet savor, that sweet incense that fills the air with the truth about God. Amen. With the truth about Jesus. And the more and more we allow our flesh to be broken, the more and more God's light begins to shine. And He gains victory. Amen. And He gets the glory. Let me tell you how He gets the glory. Because people know you and they know how you work. You know what's sad? What's sad is when you know people that they're great people. I can remember working with this one girl. I'm telling you, man, she was probably one of the best people that I'd ever known. I mean, she was just sweet as could be, had everything going for her. She was a nurse practitioner. Her husband had a great job. He owned all kind of property. I mean, dude, they were wealthy, but she was the last thing from being arrogant. She was just sweet as could be. And I can just remember sharing with her the gospel of Jesus. And she was like, well, we started. I said, no, Pam, I'm not talking about, I said her name. I'm not talking about just praying around the table. I'm talking about how you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. The problem is that we can't think that we're all good enough. And sometimes people wonder and they hate their past. And they hate the things that they've been through and all of the things that they've done. But I'm here to tell you, you need to be grateful for where you've come from. Amen. Because if you didn't go through all of that stuff, you might have thought you were okay. You might have thought that you didn't really need Jesus to die. And that you were just all right because you wasn't doing what everybody else was doing. Amen? But because of your past, because of where God brought you from, because He's breaking down that earthen vessel, amen, He wants to store His treasure, His presence on the inside of you so that other people can see the glory of God and so that they can see that God does a work in people's lives. Amen. He changed you. They know, man. They know who I was. And you know what? I hope that they understand. I hope He's changing us. Listen to me. Don't let the devil lie to you and get all frustrated because you messed up again yesterday. I mean, at least you ain't messing up like you used to. Come on.
Amen.
Huh?
That's it.
It's got to be getting a little bit better. Praise God.
Amen.
That's how the Holy Spirit works. He's going to reveal to you what needs to go. Let the Holy Spirit, let Jesus be the pastor of your heart. Amen.
Amen.
We have this treasure in earthen vessels. Amen. And God wants to allow His glory to shine on the inside of us. At the same time, when we become Christians, this is what ends up happening. I'm about to close. He says this in verse 8, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. The word troubled there is the same word that's narrow in Matthew chapter 7. You remember that? Straight is the gate, narrow is the path. See, the idea is that there's a crowd that's narrowing in and pressing on you. The world is on each side, and the pathway of Christianity is very narrow, and it's covered by a crowd, and the crowd is trying to press in. The crowd's trying to press in. It's really trying to overcome. Even we see it in the modern church. The crowd's trying to overcome and overtake Christianity. And so you're being pressed, but you're not being crushed. See, the Lord is not going to... Ultimately, what it all boils down to is this, is that when you guys became a Christian, God became your protector, but the devil also became your adversary. But one of the things that you and I need to understand is that as we walk this pathway, all the pressures of life are going to try to press you, get you off the pathway, but you will not be crushed because the worst thing, come on somebody, now listen to me, we got to think right on this. The worst thing that anybody can do is take your physical life.
Amen.
That's it.
I mean, let's just break it down to the bare. Well, I don't want to die, preacher. Well, I ain't looking to get shot in the head when I walk out of here either. But what I'm trying to say is that if my soul is right with God, the worst thing they can do is take my physical body. The Word of God says in Matthew, don't fear him who can destroy the body, but fear him who can destroy both body and soul. Lord, make my heart right with you. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So you might be pressed, but you're not going to be crushed. It goes on to talk about the fact that we are perplexed, but not in despair. I'm not going to go through each one of them, but I want you to know you're perplexed, but you're not in despair. Now I want to break down perplexed for a moment. It means I don't have a path. It means I don't have a solution. It means I've gotten to the midst of a situation and I'm perplexed.
Wow.
I'm looking and I don't know how I'm going to get out of this circumstance. this perplexed situation, listen to me, when the pressures of life come against you and the enemy of your soul, see, sometimes the problem is that in this journey of Christianity, you might not get your back, be getting your back beat like the Apostle Paul for preaching the gospel, but at the same time, there are areas of your flesh that try to stand in the way of what God is trying to do in the midst of your life. Well, can you explain flesh to me a little bit better, preacher? Because I'm having a hard time understanding. Okay, well, Matt's flesh has really struggled in the past with just buying whatever it is that Matt wants to buy. Ain't nobody, you don't tell me what I'm going to buy, buddy. Because, see, I got me a degree, and I went and made me some more money, and I'll buy what I want to buy. Well, the problem is this, is that it don't matter how much money you make, you can outspend your month, brothers and sisters. And so your flesh wants to live and says, I'm going to get what I want to get, and I'm not, nobody going to tell me, but the Lord's trying to deal with you. The Lord's trying to deal with you. He's trying to tell you, first of all, you ain't even really giving into the kingdom like you're supposed to. Don't get mad at the preacher for telling you the truth. 10% belongs to God. That's what the Word of God says. That happened long before the law ever was. And listen to me, I'd be a bad preacher if I didn't tell you. I'd be a bad preacher if I didn't tell you that a tenth of tithe belongs to the Lord. The Lord said, you have robbed me. How have we robbed you? In tithes and offerings? If you want a financial blessing in the midst of your life, I'm here to tell you right now, I'm not going to get into all the stories about how God blessed me financially and the things that he did, because this is not a prosperity lottery we're talking about here. This is another place where we submit our lives to the Lord. Amen. Amen. The Word of God says it. It came long before the law. Amen. And it talks about it in the law. And it's still supposed to be there in the New Testament. God, the first tithe was paid by Abraham, where the promise was given that Messiah would come. This is how God operates financially. But he's asking you to give into the kingdom so that he can use you in that aspect also. He wants you to freely give, though. He don't want the preacher to try. Listen, man, I heard one preacher go to somebody's house in town here. He wants to see their W-2 form. I'm like, dude, excuse me? You come walking up in my house wanting to see my W-2 form, and we probably have a flex problem. It ain't none of your business what I made. And it ain't none of my business what you made. And this is between you and Jesus. And guess what? I love you, bro. You know, I'm not over here trying to pay attention to what you're paying. Amen. And if I am, Lord, deal with me, right? The point is this. The Lord has to reveal that to you.
Yes.
The Lord reveals that to you. But I can't afford it, preacher. You can't afford not to.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, he said that with the palm of worm is left, the canker worm is eaten. The Lord knows how to put holes in people's pocket, man. You'll be walking around, you don't even know where your money's going. What I'm trying to tell you is this, is that the Lord wants to do something in your life, and sometimes your flesh is telling you to spend your money any old way you want to. And you're like, but I'll pay my tithe, preacher. And guess what? I still ain't got no money at the end of the month. That's because your flesh is in the way. You still spend your money any old way you want to. You don't pay attention to nothing that you're doing. And the problem is that it is having a disastrous effect in the midst of your life. Don't tell me, because I've had credit card debt before, buddy.
Amen.
And let me tell you something. Mr. Rockefeller, he wants his payment. And we ain't going to get into Mr. Rockefeller right now. But I'll tell you right now, he's charging 20-something percent interest. And he's making a lot of money off of people. 27% interest on credit cards, man. How are you ever going to get ahead in your life? And man, payday loans are a whole lot worse than that. That's just one aspect of flesh. In other words, what I'm trying to say is, I want what I want, and I want it right now. I'm perplexed because now I'm in the midst of a situation. I don't know how to get out. Drugs and alcohol. People are like, man, I'm tired of living my life this way, and they keep on going back to the same old thing, going back to the same old thing, and they find themselves in the midst of a circumstance, perplexed. I don't know how to get out. Relationship. I told them kids at home, a Christian, and I'm going to tell you too. If you're single, guess what? You know, youth groups across America promote people to date. Oh, find yourself a little Christian, whatever, whatever. Next thing you know, they over there making out. Next thing you know, demon spirits are all up involved in their relationships. Next thing you know, that one doesn't work out, and they have a boyfriend after 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 boyfriend. Now I'm an adult woman, and I got a boyfriend after boyfriend after boyfriend after boyfriend and a boyfriend after boyfriend. And now all I know is I know how to depend. To be dependent on a relationship. The psychology calls it codependency. I call it, it's like another drug. And let me tell you why it's another drug. Oh, I'm in this relationship. And the next thing you know, it's like endorphins start shooting off in your brain, hitting dopamine receptors, serotonin. It's just like an opiate, man. And it's like, ooh, my brain feels all good. I feel all happy. And the next thing you know, they did something that you didn't want them to do. man. And then, so you know what? You got to go get on antidepressants now to elevate your mood back again. I'm telling you, it's like a drug. You're addicted to relationships, man. Yeah, God created you to be able to have a spouse, but you need to learn how to get a hold of Jesus first.
Amen.
Let Jesus do something in your heart. Learn about the love of Jesus. Amen. But oh, my flesh was a man. My flesh was a woman. You know? And it's like, man. You know, one thing after another. Lord Jesus, you teach us how to. And then you think because you get saved and married that the lust is gone now.
No.
People get married because they think that's going to take care of the lust problem. Because now they can have sex legally. Can I just be for real? I know we got the little kid fell asleep. Just because you get married don't mean that that's going to take care of the lust problem.
Yeah. Only Jesus,
what he did at the cross and the grace that flows through that can break the power of demonic lust.
Amen.
Period.
Amen.
That's just reality, bro.
Amen.
So just make sure when you get married for the right reasons. Amen.
Preach it, brother.
Amen, sister. Yeah. So what I'm trying to say is I'm perplexed. I'm in the midst of a situation and I don't know how to get out of it. And then what happens? John got up here, man. John didn't talk but 3 minutes. And I'll tell you, that dude said so much stuff that was so good that night Luke preached. Because you know how the Lord gave him this revelation? Some girl hit him up on Facebook. And she said, I need a little help with my electric bill. And so he went and he checked out her Facebook page. And I mean, I'm not going to tell you all the stuff it had on there. But it looked like basically like kind of like she was a stripper or something like that. And I'm not trying to pick on strippers. I've known a lot of strippers. And you know what? Strippers get saved and they give their heart to Jesus and they just as good with the Lord as what I am, right? I mean, the Lord knows, right? If you hang out with strippers or you are a stripper, it's all the same thing. And so, but this is the point. There's someone right with her. She wanted some money. And so, but this is the problem. The Lord started to show John. He said, I remember him telling me on the phone, and since that time, the Lord has made it so clear to his heart. The Lord showed him, why are you going to go pay that girl's electric bill whenever I'm trying to break her? All of her life, I've been trying to get her perplexed. Amen. I've been trying to get her to a spot where she don't know whether to turn to the right. She doesn't know whether to turn to the left. And at one day, she turned to me. And the same thing happens with Christians. Yeah. We find ourselves, we keep on getting perplexed because our flesh keeps rising up. And we refuse to allow the Lord to have his way in the midst of our life. And the next thing you know, just like Matt used to do, hey, Dad. I got a little bit of an issue here, man. You think you can hit me up with a couple $100? After the Lord got a hold of me, that's one of the first things he showed me. Son, it's time you learn who your daddy is, boy. You quit asking your daddy for money. And if you have to take it, you better make sure you pay him back. But then he told me at that point, he said, you are not to ask your father, your physical father, for money anymore. And from that day moving forward, it changed the whole way that I saw my finances. It was time for Matt to grow up. Amen? And so I know that I talked a lot about money, but I'm just trying to say that oftentimes we rush in, whether it be our dad or our mom or our friend or church. We rush in to help people, and like John was saying, man, leave them people alone. Amen. Not that we don't ever help people in the church. That's not what I'm saying. But leave them people alone. Let God break them.
Amen.
Bring them to the place. Amen. Where he desires for them to be so that they might cry out to the Lord and that thing that's been plaguing their life would then be delivered from them.
Yes.
Amen. Come, help us come to the end of ourselves, Lord. Yes. And whatever it is that we've been going through, that we've been holding on to, and that you've been trying to break us, bring us to the perplexed place. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. So but we're perplexed but not in despair. And the idea of despair is that there is no hope at all. Well, that's just not true for the Christian. Amen?
Amen.
That's not true for the Christian because you have hope.
Amen.
You have hope in this life as long as there's breath in your lungs, and you really got hope once the breath leaves. Amen?
Amen.
Because over there on the other side ain't none but glory. Hallelujah. Now, I'm not going to keep on going. I'm going to end with this. But he goes on to say in verse 10, I'm closing with this. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus Christ, the life also of Jesus, might be made manifest in our body. That's verse 10. In other words, always bearing about in the death of our body the death of the Lord Jesus. so that the life may also be made manifest. You know, there has to be a real crucifixion death in order for there to be a resurrection life.
Right.
Amen.
Yeah.
And you and I need to understand that by faith we died with him.
Yes.
And we need a revelation of that. Like, I know I say it a lot, and some people may even get tired of it. I hope you don't, because it's the gospel. But you know, there's a big difference between understanding something intellectually and getting a revelation of it spiritually.
Amen.
We need the Holy Spirit to give us a revelation spiritually of the old man dying, amen, so that we can now begin to walk in resurrection life. Where the same Spirit, Romans chapter 8, verse 11, that raised Jesus from the dead, would also quicken or give life to our mortal bodies.